Talk about elastic manifolds in quantum potential. So this is a topic which has a long history. It goes back to Larkin, and who started the theory of pinning by quench disorder. And it's of interest for experiments, for instance, magnetic interface in disordered ferromagnets, or vortex lattices spin by impurities. And the focus here will be somewhat different. I will talk about the energy landscape, which has not been so much investigated. And we will study the number of equilibria, number of stationary points of this landscape. We will see that when we add an external force on the elastic manifold, this landscape somehow trivializes. And this can be related to the so-called depinning transition, in which we will make some statement. And we will also look at the Hessian of the energy functional at the global minimum of the system. And whether there are modes, and whether this, that is, whether this Hessian is spectrum is gapped from zero or not. Okay, so this summary of the work done with Jan Fyodorov in these papers, and also a paper with Alberto Rosso and Christophe Texier a bit earlier. Okay, so it will be blackboard, and I will start with something simple, which is a polymer, so a directed polymer. So if I write too small, please tell me. So this is just a simple string, if you want, in a random potential. So there is some internal coordinate for the string. It can be discrete or continuous. So it could have discrete monomers, or it could be continuous variable x, and it has some field u of x, which gives you the displacement of the polymer from this axis. So it's a directed string. It has some tension. And it corresponds to the case which is called d equal 1. N equal 1, meaning that internal dimension of the manifold is 1, and number of components of the displacement field is also 1. So the energy functional, I will write in a continuum, but we have also, of course, looked at the discrete case. So I will first write a term which is elastic energy with some elastic coefficient. And then it is actually convenient to put this elastic string in a quadratic potential. So I will add some quadratic potential. So that makes the problem better defined. And it, so there's this mass parameter, we call it mass. And it ensures that at sufficiently large scale, larger than this length scale, so it introduces a length scale such that above this length scale, the interface is, enfin, the string is essentially flat. And I need to check the time, okay. And of course, there is also the random potential. So it's a function of u of x and x. It's a function. So I think that there are impurities in this ux space described by this function, this random potential. And we are going to add also some external force in a second stage to study depinning transition. OK, so this random potential is supposed to be, we're going to choose some Gaussian distribution for it with some two-point correlation function, which will form. It will be a delta function in the internal space, and it will have some shape described by a function r of u, which we're going to assume to be smooth in the sense that it has to have at least a fourth derivative for what we're going to do, and which describes the correlation in the direction of u. Okay, so the limit, one limit of interest is a limit goes to zero, which is a limit where the system becomes critical. This length scale diverges, and then, as is known, there is roughness, break roughness for this ground state of this manifold or this string and some exponent. And in particular case, is 1 plus 1 dimensions, exponent is known to be third. We're not going to be interested in that. We are going to look at slightly different things. So there is a length scale is introduced by the random potential, the Larkin length. I'm going to define like this. So it involves the fourth derivative of this function with the power 1/3 in one dimension. And this length scale is well known since Larkin papers and Larkin of Shinnikov to be such that if you look at a system of scale larger than LC, then you start having metastability. So no metastability below LC and metastability above LC. This was confirmed by functional normalization group methods, which I'm not going to talk about, replica symmetry breaking. And what we are going to do here, so I'm going to give one of the first results we have, which is we're going to look at this. Okay, so Larkin also predicted from this phenomenological theory, a phenomenological argument to predict that there would be a deepening threshold which is related to this length scale, which is basically average, the typical force acting on a volume of size LC. And this, so this would be the prediction of Larkin, which I'm going to write like this. So it's related to the Larkin length. Kappa is elastic. And this is the correlation length of the random potential.
I'm trying to understand the terminology. So without the mass, once you cross the threshold, it moves, right?
Yeah, yeah, without the mass, it's moving, yes. Yeah, if you keep the mass, it's going to move and it's going to stop somewhere else. Yeah. So that's why if we really would talk about depinning, we have to take the mass to zero. Okay. Yeah, yeah, velocity behaves trickily. But we're not going to do any dynamics. Okay. So the argument of Larkin, and I'm not going to reproduce a phenomenology, it's very interesting, but I need to move on. So if the applied force is bigger, uniform, if it's bigger than Fc, then there are no more barriers to motion, and the system is NP. The critical force is, maybe I write it here, is that we show from, so as was pointed out, we need to be in the limit m goes to zero, l goes to infinity. So l is the size of the string, the length of the string. And from studying the landscape, we found an upper bound on this critical force. And I'm going to write it here. So this is one of our results. That's an exact expression for this bound. Okay, it's only a bound, but and this coefficient is determined from some solving some equation. I'll come back to it. And this bound holds for any function r of u, which has to be sufficiently differentiable. So we check this bound with Rosso and in of u. So it's the charge density wave case. And in that, we found that this bound is about 1.6, the actual deepening threshold. And both of them actually behaving like sigma to the fourth. Okay, so what do we do exactly? No, it's actually the same estimate you can dimensionally. But what we have is the prefactor, the number, yes. Yeah, an estimation really very qualitative. Yeah. No barrier means that you know if you apply a force the thing will move, but that it's like one particle in one dimension, right? So at some point the force is sufficient and there is no more barrier to motion. So motion is unbounded. So this is so it will appear as a dispersion of the equilibria. I mean, no more equilibria, no more state equilibria. But it's a dynamical concept. You know, usually people look at zero temperature relaxational dynamics in this landscape, and from this they define the critical force. Okay. Sorry? Well, okay. This Larkin force was, you know, a dynamical concept, yes. But we're going to get to it from a calculation of stable equilibria. We hope to do it. So what are we doing? We're going to count equilibrium. So equilibria means that configuration u of x of this string, so that's this derivative 0 for all x. And of course, it includes minima, saddle point, and maxima. And we're going to count them using the Kac-Rice formula, which is telling you that the total number for a string of size L is by the following formula. So it's counting the number of zero of a function. So here it's a set of conditions, but the formula works for that. So there is first the delta function term, and then there is absolute value of determinant. So it's a well-known formula. Okay. So now this is true for any configuration, any realization of the random potential. And so I can average over the random potential. Or I could, if I want, calculate moments, but it's more difficult. So I'm just going to calculate average. And as was noticed by Jan a long time ago, in this type of averages, you have actually a decoupling, because H of U is this, it's functional here. It's a total energy. So in this derivative, as you can see, the potential V prime, the derivative of the potential will appear, derivative with respect to U, if I explicitly write it. I'm not going to do it, but and now if I explicitly write the Hessian, which I will do later, you'll see that there'll be the second derivative of V coming out. Just functional derivative of this, right? Now, what noticed by Jan is that if you take just a simple this simple average, well, these things will be evaluated at the same point, which is u, and this average at the same point, ux, this is actually R3 of 0 times Kronecker delta or delta. And so this is zero because I suppose that the function is sufficiently smooth, and this function is actually even. Okay. So then it means that these two factors are actually independent statistically, and I can average them separately. Okay. And, now the average of this value of determinant doesn't depend on u. Actually, you can see that it's completely independent of the choice of u once I average. So then it means I can calculate separately this thing and then this integral. Okay. And what you find if you do that is you find the following formula. Maybe I will write it. Okay, let me write it here. So if you do that, you find that n of l is a ratio of two determinants. So now this h is not a curly h, it's a straight h, okay? Sorry for the notation. And what is it? So it's actually a Schrödinger operator. So it's minus d2 dx squared plus u of x. And H0 is the same thing without the U. And there's an average. tensile with respect to the disorder. Now, what is u of x? U of x, when I calculate the Hessian, I get the second derivative. So u of x actually v double prime of u of x x over, so there's just a rescaling by kappa. And that's a white noise, actually. Okay, so this is the statement that this is this with here equal 2d delta x minus x prime. And d from this formula is simply r4 of 0 divided by kappa. Okay, so we have mapped the problem relating the number of the mean number of equilibria to a ratio, averaging a ratio of determinant for Schrödinger operator. The denominator here comes from the calculation of this delta function here. So this integral gives you the denominator, and the numerator is just simply this one. Okay, so now how do we calculate this function determinant? So-called Galfond-Yaglom method, which allows to do that. And what we find is that y of x, I mean, the statement is that you can transform it into an initial value problem by defining y of x, which is solution of the problem hy equal e times y, where e is minus kappa, minus m square over kappa. And the initial condition, so it's a shooting problem. You construct a function which satisfies this initial condition, and which is an eigenfunction with this value of the energy. And now the statement is that this determinant here is essentially the value of the function at point L. So you know the function at O, you iterate this equation, and this ratio will be y of L divided by y0 of L, and I have to average absolute value. So the determinant is y of L. It's relatively easy to show it. So we have transformed this into now a shooting problem on this random Schrödinger equation. And as is well known, this y of L grows exponentially for each realization of the disorder. And people have introduced, since Vulpiani and Paladin and so on, have introduced a generalized Lyapunov exponent, which is telling you how lambda of q, how the qth moment of such problem, such a solution, grows for a random operator. So then it means that what we have for the number of total number of equilibria is just exponential growth, and the rate of the growth will be lambda of 1 minus Planck scale Lm minus 1, which is just the denominator here. So the denominator is a trivial calculation and gives you just this. So we have to now evaluate this. Okay. Now this generalized Lyapunov exponent has been, of course, much studied, and there are some perturbative expansion, but in a regime where the energy is positive and large, the semi-classical limit, which is not of interest for us here. We want the regime where energy is negative. So just in one very fast, this is obtained by looking at the stochastic Riccati equation for the variable y prime over y. Problem can be mapped. It's a standard thing. So this is a variable y prime over y, and it can be mapped on the Langevin equation at some temperature, let's say 1, or proportional to the disorder, in a cubic potential, cubic plus linear potential. It's a minimum, local minimum, controlled by this. Yes. Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Well, because you know, I mean, it's Osiridek. You start from one end, so they grow. No, 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 no. No, it goes down if you tune. If you tune, that's precisely what, okay. Yeah, no, they grow. They explode. Some special value are where they go down, but for generic value, they grow, okay? Yeah. Okay, so for those of you who know the type of problem, I mean, this is a stochastic Rikert equation, which is a motion of a particle in this cubic potential, as was found Alperin a long time ago, the density of state. So you can perturbation theory around this point, but strangely enough, it gives you that the rate actually is zero. So if you do perturbative calculation. So if you really want to get the rate correct, you need to look at the jumps over this, and when the energy is relatively large, so for large mass, this is proportional to the density of states, okay? So it has some Lifshitz tail. So it's a long story, but let me just tell you the result that we got from analysis we did with Christophe Texier, that we found that the rate R, so I rate of growth, it's a function of, let's say, scaling function, which I can write like this. And this function g of y is cy. So we have a very good characterization of this function. It's not an exact expression, but we have all the asymptotics and so on both sides. So this is the limit m go to zero, in which case the rate, so this quantity is the same as here. And the rate is c over the Larkin length, that limit. And this is the other limit where the mass go to infinity, tails. Okay, and then we have some claim, but this is, has to be discussed, it's a bit subtle, of whether this function is universal or not. So the next point is to add an external force. When we add the external force, so when we add the external force, as you can see, the force acts only linearly, doesn't enter the Hessian. So the external force will only enter this factor here. So it's very easy to calculate what it does. So in presence of external force, exponentially with the same factor r as before, but there's an additional term f squared over 2 r double prime 0. So what happens is that if the force is sufficiently large, so this is the bound which I wrote here, then if the force is bigger, then there is no equilibrium, no equilibria in a typical sample. Because the average number equilibria now doesn't grow exponentially anymore, it actually goes to zero. Okay, so this provides an upper bound on the depending threshold force. Okay, so let me go now to the second part of the talk. Is there some question? No? Okay, so second part of the talk is going to look at the same problem now, but with n-component manifold, and we're going to take the mean field limit, n going to infinity. So what we are going to do is to look at the generalization of the model for n-component. So it would be the mean to infinity. Okay, so we're going to look at an object now which can have some internal dimension, which can be so there's some internal coordinate which lives in RD or ZD. And the displacement field now becomes n-component vector. So this is the embedding space, this is the internal space. And you can think of a vortex line, for instance, in three dimension, which would have d equal 1 because it's a line, but it will have n equal 2 components filled, okay, if you have a vortex line in three dimension. So let me write again the energy functional now for this problem. So it will be very similar to the other one, but I'm changing a bit notation to different, several different papers and authors. So I'm going to stick to the notation of this last paper. So this is again the confining energy. So this was like the square of the mass, and this is a Laplacian. It can be discrete Laplacian, or it can be a continuum. So this term is an elastic energy, if you want. If you integrate by part, I get this. So it's still an elastic manifold, and it has, again, this external potential. And then eventually, I will add some force, which I will scale in some particular way. Okay. So the Laplacian here is... So X belongs to LD. Some over X can be also an integral if I'm in a continuum. And the modes of the Laplacian are just the plane waves. So the Laplacian in one dimension would be, just to fix the idea, would be just for a chain, it would be like this, and it would be minus K squared for a continuum model. So this is a D1 chain. And this is a continuum model in in any actually dimension. And I will denote integral k to be a sum of the modes. Okay, so in a continuum, it will be a continuum integral. Okay, and now I need to define again the random potential. And now, since I'm in an n-dimensional space, I will choose it. So and I will scale it with n appropriately, so that there is a large n limit, which is well defined. So it will have this type of form. Okay, so I'm interested now in the Hessian matrix. So run some configuration, U of X. So I'm going to write the Hessian matrix. And so in the spectrum of this matrix, so the Hessian will have the form K I X G Y. So it has an index which is internal index. So this lives in Rn. So I is going from 1 to n. And X and Y are inside the position inside the manifold, okay? So this is just, by definition, second derivative. Of the functional H. And it has the following form. And then there is Kronecker delta in internal, some local piece in internal space, which is some random matrix. And this random matrix is the second derivative of the potential. Okay. So this is the form of to look at the spectrum of this Hessian. How much more time do I have? Seventeen. Okay, so I can draw the Hessian. I can draw the matrix. Huh? Oula, that's small. Okay, so let me write. So you can write this matrix as it's an n LD times an LD matrix. And you can write it in different ways. Let me just write it in a continuum version. So I take D equal 1, and I take the continuum version of this, and it's an n by n matrix, which has the four. So it's an operator matrix in this case. And then on the diagonal is this Schrodinger type operator, but now the W's are n by n matrices. Sorry, the W's, Wij are given, defined by this, so there are some random numbers, and this is an n by n operator matrix. Matrix operator, so which acts on function of x. You can also write it as an L by L block matrix, where each block has a n by n. So there are various ways to write it. Okay, so what are we interested in? We are interested in calculating spectrum of this Hessian, and there are actually two questions. One is around the Hessian around a general point, and the other one is the Hessian around the absolute minimum of the energy. Okay, so the Hessian, so we will be do n going to infinity first, and the size L is fixed. But eventually we can take L to infinity, but only after. And we want to find the density of states, rho of lambda, for the Hessian, either for a general point. For the ground state, which I call u0 of x. Okay, so in the first case, we use a single set of replica to calculate the resolvent. And we get results which are comparable to the one of Pasteur for orbital models with lattice Laplacian. In that case, if u is generic and fixed, you can choose equal zero, for instance, doesn't change anything. So this has just some simple correlation. And it's essentially a GOE matrix plus some random diagonal part. And of course, it's more complicated when you ask about the global energy minimum. In that case, we need actually two sets of replicas. Give the details, but essentially, the idea is to look at the, to write the resolvent. So this is what we do. We want to write the resolvent. And okay, so it's difficult to impose this condition. So what we do is we look at the system at finite temperature. So we introduce the resolvent at finite temperature. We call it T, some average using a Boltzmann, the Gibbs measure, of the resolvent for an arbitrary point times the Gibbs weight. And then what we want to do is we want to average this. So we want to calculate the disorder average of this. And as you see, the random potential appears here because it appears in K. And it appears also in H. It appears also there. So you need to introduce replica to do that. And at the end of the day, so temperature goes to zero, then we'll ensure that we are talking about the ground state. One set of replica is to deal with this Gibbs measure. The other one is to deal with this green function of some average, which I'm going to write, and some action with control by big N. Okay, so we take all these limits. And we also take N to infinity, so that's a lot of limits. So you hope everything is fine, and what do you find? Okay, so let me describe the result now. the result is with a self-consistent equation for the green function, for the diagonal green function, for which we can get the density of state. So the self-consistent equation is the following. So this is the diagonal average of the diagonal green function. Let me call it IP, and this is given by some integral mu effective So it's a self-consistent equation because you want to determine the parameter p. And the density of state is just, once you know parameter p, it's just imaginary part of ip. And so if you effective, if I look at a Hessian around a point, then this parameter mu effective is just mu, the original mass parameter in the system. And then we get the so-called Pasteur self-consistent equation, which we have analyzed, and we have exact form actually for the density in one dimension. Since it has a nice explicit form in terms of a solution of a cubic equation. I'm not going to write it in detail, but it has a form like this. As a function of this scaling variable here. With some explicit expression which you can find in our paper. And so this would be for the generic point. But the whole, if you look now at the ground state, the whole non-triviality of the optimization of the ground state is in this simple parameter mu effective. So what it's telling you is that the shape of the density of state, the shape of the density of state is already determined at this level without imposing the condition on the ground state. And it will shift, so it will be simply a shift. The condition on the ground state will be simply a shift of the position, not the shape, but just the position of this density of state. Okay, so let me now briefly describe what happens with this shift, and in particular whether there is a gap or not. And so there are two situations. Either the mass is bigger that, of course, to calculate this mu effective, one has to really the replica problem, and it can have replica symmetry breaking. So one has to really do the saddle point here with the replica and go for replica symmetry breaking. And what we find is that if mu is bigger than mu c, so mu c defined, mu c is what we call the Larkin mass. So it's the solution of this equation. It's a unique solution. So this determines uniquely, you see the Larkin mass. This is the disorder, B double prime of zero. For instance, in one dimension, in a continuum model, is B double prime zero square root t to the 2/3. One. So if mu is bigger than mu c, we find that it's a symmetric phase. And the effective mass is given by some formula, which, okay, and then we have a formula also for the edge, the position of the edge. So the effective mass as a function of mu is given by this. And we find some position for the edge. I'm not going to write the formula. So lambda e, so this is going now to be shifted. And, lower edge lambda e minus will be at this position. So this would be density of states, and this would be lambda. And lambda e is positive if mu bigger than mu c, and it vanishes at mu c quadratically. So if we are below, if the mass now is below mu c, then replica symmetry breaking, and there are two cases. The first case is when there is a full replica symmetry breaking or continuous replica symmetry breaking, and that happens for long-range model. So the type of model we are looking at are Paolo correlation for Paolo correlation. So B of Q again is the correlator, and if gamma. So this long and for all gamma, and between for d smaller than 2, gamma has to be sufficiently small, so to be long range. Case is that the mu effective actually freezes at mu c, so the value of mu effective is just the same expression with mu c, and it implies that lambda e minus is actually zero. Okay, so with the whole in the whole full replica symmetry breaking phase, this actually goes to zero here. And so lambda e minus is at zero. And the shape around here is a semicircle, it's like the semicircle. And in fact, if you look at the particle dimension, so it will be a zero dimensional manifold, then it's an exact semicircle, the density. But if you have a manifold finite dimension D, you have, of course, different shape of the density, but around zero, around zero, it will be still a semicircle. Okay, and then there is a second case, which is a one-step replica symmetry breaking, when the disorder is more short-range. So it happens d smaller than 2 and gamma bigger than its critical value. And then the gap actually away from 0 is not 0, so it's mu c minus mu to the power 4. So it increases again, mu becomes, it vanishes at mu c, but then increases again. So in that case, there are no soft modes. So this is a general picture. And there are interesting marginal cases, which I call 1, which is marginal. Marginal means it has both features of short range of full replica symmetry breaking and one step replica symmetry breaking. It's at the boundary of the full replica symmetry breaking, if you want. And it includes the log correlated case that people are studying heavily. And there are generalization for manifold of higher, this for a point, and for higher dimensional manifold, d equal 1, d equal 2. Marginal and have similar behavior. Okay, so how much time? 5 minutes, okay. So let me finish other questions. So let me finish talking about complexity of the manifold case. Maybe let me do this here. So, in a large n limit, one can calculate a bit more things than for the string. So we can actually calculate mean, but also of equilibria, but also the number of stable equilibria. So we have actually, so this work is in progress, but we have a formula for these two quantities for the manifold. And what's interesting, so I'm going to write the formula explicitly. I mean, let me give you the main point. The main point is that this complexity function vanishes at mu c again, mu c, but it vanishes cubic. So it's positive for mu smaller than mu c. So maybe I should put mu c minus mu. So it's zero mu. So this is for mu smaller than mu c, sorry. And this is zero for mu bigger than mu c. And it has cubic third order transition. And we can also, from this formula, we can obtain the what we would define as Larkin length. So it's another way of defining the Larkin length, which is to put the growth. So this, we can write it like this. That would find a Larkin scale, Larkin length, which agrees actually nicely, has similar form as the one which are expected from Larkin, I mean from Larkin one dimension, for instance. But what's interesting is that we can now define a threshold critical force based on a stable equilibria. And by adding a force, we can repeat the same procedure. And we find now the force beyond which there is no more stable equilibria. So if F is bigger than FC ST, there is no stable equilibria. And okay, we're still, work is in progress. Actually, hope that this is actually the exact expression for the deepening threshold in this large n limit. And I think I'm done.